Good morning. Welcome to the next presentation of the Earthquake Country Alliance Safer at Home webinar series. So today, the topic is step five, drop, cover, and hold on, and other self-protective actions. My name is Shannon Mulhall. I work as the Americans with Disabilities Act coordinator for the City of Fresno. Next slide. I also serve as the chair of the Seniors and People with Disabilities Committee for the Earthquake Country Alliance, ECA. ECA is a partnership of many public, private, and grassroots leaders in organizations and communities across California. Everyone can join our mailing list to get updates about future webinars and other activities at earthquakecountry.org/alliance. And we will put that webpage up in the chat in a moment. I'd like to give special thanks today to the City of Los Angeles Department on Disability for sponsoring our closed caption and the sign language interpreters today. We believe that communication access is really critical. All right, so our webinar series is following ECA's 7 steps to earthquake safety. These are simple actions to improve safety before, during, and after earthquakes. You can learn about all of the steps at earthquakecountry.org/7steps and in Spanish at terremotos.org/7pasos. We will put both of those in the chat as well. Here is the planned schedule for other webinars in our Safer at Home series. I hope you can participate. The goal here is to provide information that you and your family can use to be safer at home and for you to be a resource in your community following a major earthquake. Visit earthquakecountry.org/safer at home to see when to registration is open for each webinar. All right, if you've just joined, again, my name is Shannon Mulhall, and I work as the Americans with Disabilities Act coordinator for the City of Fresno. I also serve as the chair of the Seniors and People with Disabilities Committee for the Earthquake Country Alliance. This webinar is being recorded and will be available on the ECA website next week. In order to ask questions of the presenter, please use the Q&A feature down at the bottom. You just click on Q&A at the bottom of your screen and type in the question. Now we have a fantastic set of presenters today from across California who will talk about what you need to do to take protective action during an earthquake. We're also joined by Jason Ballman and Sharon Sandow de Groot from the Southern California Earthquake Center and Robert de Groot from the United States Geological Survey. USGS, who will be moderating the chat and Q&A. I'll do an introduction of each person before they speak. All right, so here's what we're going to talk about today. Our presenters will discuss the research about how people get injured during an earthquake as the basis for why certain self-protective actions are recommended. We're going to talk about what to know and what you should do to take action, including if you get an alert in advance of an earthquake. We're going to talk about what to do in various settings and what to do with various capabilities, including if you have a disability. So I would like to introduce our first presenter, Michelle Woods, professor and chair at the California State University Fullerton Department of Public Health. Michelle, take it away.
Hello, thank you. It's such a pleasure to be here. My task is to synthesize thousands of pages of dry research into the key points for us in 10 minutes, which is what I will attempt to do. I'm going to talk about the evidence. So I want to start with the drop, cover, hold on evidence supporting why we recommend those actions. It really boils down to 3 key findings when we look at all the causes of death and injury. And those 3 things are: there's increased risk when people come in and out of buildings, moving in and out of buildings. In Whittier Narrows earthquake, in the Loma Prieta and Northridge earthquake, that was associated with increased injury risk. And in Northridge, when people moved, they had higher rates of injury, and falls was the thing that led to the highest number of hospitalized injuries. And this was mostly when people were entering and exiting buildings. The second thing is there is risk from objects that fall, falling, flying, sliding objects. And this was apparent in the Kocaeli earthquake with 85% of the deaths in injuries from being struck by objects. And movement is the third. When people move, they are at higher risk of injury. And, you know, in Turkey, we found staying put, sitting down was the safest place to be, the safest thing to do. In Canterbury, tripping and falling was the most common cause of injury. And many other research studies replicate those same findings. Next, please. Okay, I want to show this video of drop cover hold on in real time. And this is the Anchorage earthquake in 2018.
You need, don't let yourself be convinced to do something that you know is bad. And then Ian, finally be sure to go.
So folks were able to drop cover and hold on within about 4 to 5 seconds. And video captures like this, which was captured by the school district, and exciting video research done by Lambie and colleagues in New Zealand of earthquakes in real time, really demonstrate the value and importance of holding on as cover can shift during the shaking and how that can be protective. Next slide, please. Okay, there are many other indoor situations I want to talk about real briefly. We have evidence mainly provided by FEMA and other researchers that being in a corner where there are two walls can provide more protection. And part of that is because there are objects flying from fewer directions. So the space can be sturdier and it can be have fewer objects coming towards it. Low-lying furniture has been found to be protective and can help deflect objects that are moving around in a room. But the issue here is we have to weigh the risk of moving to go get to that space versus the risk of being struck. So if you move, you may fall and be struck, but you would get some cover, some degree of protection. So this requires some judgment, and I'm going to come back to this at the end and talk about situational awareness. There's a lot of other research. I want to talk about the fire. Fire is considered the most deadly secondary disaster that can follow an earthquake. And the issue here is if people are in really dangerous situations, like a lab with open flame and chemicals, or a stove that's on, and if it topples, that could ignite a fire. And so that's a little challenging to navigate. And so when folks are in that kind of really risky situation, it may be safer to move. It may be safer to extinguish a flame if you're right next to it. And that again is gonna require situational awareness because there's the risk of movement versus the risk of flame. Okay, next slide, please. Oh, sorry, driving. I forgot about driving. We have evidence, some research on driving over correction that happens. So our guidance about driving is based on driver over correction, delayed response time, and how this has caused drivers to move into adjacent lanes, and also the problems with infrastructure being compromised and perhaps introducing risk. Next slide. So for coastal and tsunami areas, the research, the guidance becomes more complicated because we've got earthquake risk and tsunami risk. And One of the points of evidence is that if people begin to move to protect themselves from a tsunami immediately while the ground is still shaking, that puts them at risk for injury from the earthquake. So this underlies the guidance that we provide on that point, which we'll get to later in the presentation. And also, we know that the death and injury and damage from a tsunami can surpass that of an earthquake. So it's really important to take protective action as soon as it's safe to move. We also find that most buildings aren't designed to withstand a tsunami, but when higher ground isn't available, tall buildings may be able to provide protection if there aren't other options. Next slide. Okay, so we have the evidence that we use that undergirds our guidance for those with disabilities and access and functional needs is based on professional practice and expertise and membership in those communities. It's based on logic, on indirect evidence about the importance of cover, and evidence supporting the importance of avoiding falls. Next slide. So I wanted to talk to you a little bit about some guidance that exists that we don't recommend. And so this includes taking cover in a doorway. Basically, the evidence indicates that doorways don't really, in general, do not provide any more protection than anywhere else. And that moving to a doorway introduced the risk of injury, of being struck by an object, of falling. And there could even be a rush of people reaching that doorway. Similarly, the recommendation for the triangle of life recommendation, which is to anticipate where a void might be so that you would be protected if the building collapses. The rationale and evidence here is in the US, our buildings don't usually collapse. And it's not really possible to identify in advance where those voids will be. And again, moving introduces risk of injury from being struck by falling, flying, sliding objects. And you know, the important point there is all that injury really leads to surges in hospitals, which makes it much more difficult to manage all of the injury and you know, the people who need help. So it's beyond just being injured in the house, it's then what happens in the healthcare system. Okay, so all of the research we've collected over the years, you know, if you boil it all down, there are some general principles of earthquake safety. So in addition to teaching things like drop, cover, hold on, it's important to teach the principles too, because this will help people make decisions when they're in unique situations, and that can help them make choices to protect themselves. So getting low to the ground. This is related to our evidence about the risks associated with falling and all of the injury that happens when people fall. So if you get low to the ground, you're less likely to fall. It also means that you're going to be smaller, and being smaller reduces your risk of being struck by objects. So it makes you a smaller target. Related, we know in the Northridge earthquake, the most common part of the body that was injured among people who died was the head. So protecting one's head is an important part of our guidance and recommendations. And this one about turning off flames, you know, it's complicated because we wouldn't say, well, run across the room to find your stove and make sure it's turned off. If you were, you know, there's risk then introduced that could create more risk. But if a person is near a flame and it can be done, that might be protective. So teaching the principles can help people make those decisions based on where they're located. Now we have earthquake early warning. Earthquake early warning can give us some lead time so that people can say, ooh, if I get that flame, I can then protect myself. I can drop, cover, hold on. But the challenge is we don't at this point in time know how much time we'll have. So we can't really say it's okay to move across the room to go outside. We don't know how much time people will have, and that could make them very vulnerable to pieces of the building falling off as they exit the building if shaking were to begin. So we want to balance all of this, these competing concerns, by teaching the basic principles. I think that wraps up my slides.
Thank you, Michelle. Very informative. I got chills watching that video. I don't know if anyone else did as well, because it was such a great model. Before we continue to the next presenter, we'll pause for questions from the Q&A. Sharon, do we have any questions?
We do. We have a question from Juan Andre that says, Dr. Wood, I've been studying a lot of your work for my doctoral dissertation regarding PAs during earthquakes. A question, Mexican authorities tend to suggest that drop cover hold on does not fit to Mexican reality. What is your opinion about that?
Well, I think this is an area where experts don't always agree. I worked with Geohazards International for a while, and they developed a handbook for messaging about protective actions worldwide. And the fact is, our building codes and our buildings are different than what exists in Mexico. And in different parts of the world, the building stock varies. So depending on the building stock in the community, the guidance may vary. And it may vary if there's early warning. So I can say that honest, good researchers don't completely align on the best advice. So that again comes back to this, the importance of teaching people the basic principles so that they can make the best choice in their particular situation. I hope that answers your question. It was a good one.
Thank you. We have a question from Gregory. Do we have any statistics to show how many injuries have been minimized by following these procedures?
Do we have any evidence of the number of injuries that are, that work is really hard to do. And I don't believe that particular approach, that we have much evidence on projecting the amount of injury prevented. We do have rates comparing injuries for people who moved and didn't move, for example. In the Northridge earthquake, it was a difference of a few percent, several percentage points. You know, so there is some data that looks at the rate of injury if you tried to move, if you didn't try to move. And we got that by looking at hospital records. So there's some really good research for the three California earthquakes that looked at those kinds of injury records. And that will be included in the reference list that we provide. So you can get into the actual numbers there.
Thank you. I have another question. What about if I'm in bed?
If you're in bed, the research is pretty consistent that being in bed is a pretty safe place to be. So we have found that in some in the earthquakes where we have the data, being in bed and asleep was actually safer than being in bed awake, and being in bed awake was safer than being outside of, up and sitting still, and that was safer than being up and moving around. So being in bed keeps you still, and we have some guidance about protecting yourself while you're in bed.
Thank you.
All right, does that wrap up our question, Sharon?
It does, thank you.
Great, thank you for those great questions. And thank you, Michelle, for your expertise. As a quick reminder, our interpreters will be rotating every 15 minutes. So if you need the interpreters and you want to pin the active interpreter, put your cursor over the image of the interpreter. In the top right corner will be three dots. Click the three dots and select pin video. And that'll help you have that video as your primary video. So now I'd like to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Sarah McBride, Shake Alert Social Science Coordinator with the United States Geological Survey. Sarah, floor is yours.
Thank you so much for having me here today. I'm honored to be presenting on behalf of the U.S. Geological Survey. Like Michelle, Dr. Woods, I'm also a social scientist, and I work closely with Michelle on a number of projects. I'm going to discuss protective actions, really dovetailing into Michelle's talk, and how we're implementing Michelle and other researchers' work into the Shake Alert Earthquake Early Warning System, which is the earthquake early warning system on the West Coast of the United States. So we know from Michelle's talk why we chosen drop, cover, and hold on. It's a combination of injury data, but it's also actions that make the most sense in terms of the safety, but also in terms of timing. And timing is going to be an important discussion that we have today. Next slide. So how does drop, cover, and hold work? Well, Michelle went through this, but the first action is arguably the most critical, and that is where you stop where you are and drop to the floor safely. This reduces the breaking of a limb while moving during shaking. And the second action, covering, is helpful because it protects you from falling objects falling on top of you. Sturdy tables and desks provide a lot of protection. And the final action is hold on, which helps stabilize you during shaking. Now it's important to consider drop, cover, and hold on as it represents a whole suite of protective actions. There's advice on what to do when you're in a vehicle, in bed, like Michelle just answered wonderfully. Just stay in bed. And what to do outdoors, stay outdoors. And a list of do's and don'ts, like don't get into a doorway and don't run outside, where Michelle covered it in her talk. Now I just quickly wanna talk, next slide. I quickly wanna talk about some of the barriers as to why people don't do shake out and drop, cover, and hold on. Drop, cover, and hold on has been a part of the protect and action advice for earthquakes via the shakeout drill since 2008 in the United States, and has expanded to nations around the world. One of these nations, New Zealand, conducted extensive monitoring and evaluation research on shakeout. I was involved and led one of these projects on the barriers as to why people may not feel comfortable doing shakeout. And I found the results really interesting. We took two different drills, 3 years apart, one from 2012 and one from 2015, and asked people to observe other people doing the drill. We had more than 9,000 citizen science observers volunteer their experiences to us and tell us their stories. What we found was that these observers interpreted the number one reason of not doing the drill was actually embarrassment, which surprised us researchers. We hadn't really considered an embarrassment a really big issue. We'd assumed that there were gonna be other reasons, particularly lack of not knowing what to do being the number one reason. But we also found more information that, you know, people were too busy to do the drill. There's an issue with caretakers of children and teachers who focus on protecting children first and then don't get a chance to protect themselves either. So the other monitoring and evaluation work on shakeout was Lauren Vanell's work, which shows that people who do the drill are much more likely in an actual earthquake, which occurred in New Zealand, to take the drop, cover, and hold protective action. So shakeout is really critical for people being successful in doing drop, cover, and hold on during an actual earthquake. So this work and Michelle's and others all helped us form ideas around the shake alert system. I'm gonna quickly talk about the shake alert system before I go into protective actions. Just wanna kind of talk a little bit more about how the shake alert system works. The USGS manages the shake alert earthquake early warning system, and we have more than 60 partners within this system. And we certainly do not do this alone. Sorry, I should have said next slide. The success of the system relies on strong partnerships, like the one we have with Cal OES, our state emergency managers. If you live in the state of California, you can now receive alerts via smartphone apps, which Cal OES is gonna talk a little bit more about, the Google Android operating system, and wireless emergency alerts distributed via the FEMA IPAWS system. And we're always adding new technologies to the alerting system, so watch this space. Here's how Shake Alert works. We have a densely packed seismic network in the state of California, which can pick up seismic waves. Once four of these sensors pick up the seismic waves, it sends out information back quickly to our processing center, which then distributes the alert packet of information to our distribution partners. And again, this includes apps and Google, but also BART, so that BART can slow down trains, among other automated systems. Next slide, please. So what do we recommend if you get an earthquake alert? Now it's important to note, and this is back to protective actions, and what we recommend for shake alert, just to note that it is not earthquake prediction. The earthquake is already on its way. It's coming. And that means we only have seconds to alert people that stronger shaking is imminent. So we considered our options for the best protective action information to provide people, given we only have a few seconds to communicate an earthquake and stronger shaking is arriving. So given the amount of time anyone has after talking to people like Michelle Woods and myself and a lot of other social scientists in reviewing the literature, as well as our emergency management colleagues, it was decided the best course of action for most people is the drop, cover, hold on suite of actions. So this is the decision that we have made. So next slide, please. So given that we have such little amount of time, after we detect an earthquake and process the information and determine the alerting area and send out the alerts by our partners, drop, cover, and hold on appears to be the safest thing to do when you receive an alert. This is an action that people are already learning to do via the shake alert drill. So asking them to do something completely different with only a few seconds to spare, it's a really complex endeavor and can be pretty risky, and one that may not necessarily lead to better outcomes. I really enjoy this quote from our Los Angeles United School District Administrators, Jill Barnes. She once said, shake alert asks you to do what you're already doing, but sooner. Next slide. So one of the things, it's the social science working group, the slide before. So one of the things that I really enjoy about working for the USGS and in the Shake Alert system is that this is a learning system. We're scientists and we're researchers, and we're constantly researching and learning how to alert people better, whether there is a newer algorithm or a better way of communicating. Now, I'm the coordinator of the social science working group within the Shake Alert system, and the USGS has committed funding into understanding this system and how people can use it better. We have 12 research projects across 5 states and collaborations with 4 different nations outside the United States to gather information. So we have more than 20 researchers involved in this project, including the fantastic Michelle Wood. And we study as a team how human behavior, perceptions, and attitudes can impact people's understanding and response to the Shake Alert system. So if you do receive an earthquake alert powered by the Shake Alert system, the advice is still the same as ShakeOut, which is drop, cover, and hold on. And that's it for me. I think that's my last slide. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sarah. Sharon, are there any questions?
Yes, we have a question from Kayla. Best practices and principles can change over time. How often is this body of work and research revisited?
That's a great question. So we look at best practice research continually, and we're constantly updating how we look at things. We have a review process that happens pretty much annually right now as we review and revise. However, if we have an earthquake and an alert that goes out and maybe things didn't work out the way that we anticipated, we make changes right away. And we do incorporate research all the time into adapting and improving the Shake Alert system.
Thank you. Don asks, were the majority of the people who were too embarrassed to do the drill women or men, and what percentage?
Oh man, that is such a great question, and thank you for asking that. And we actually didn't collect demographic data from the observers because there were so many people that they were observing at any one time. You know, they were observing 50, 60 people sometimes. Sometimes they were only observing 4 or 5. So the cohort was gonna be mixed. And this was a generalization that we asked them to make. So we don't really know the gender split. And it's important to note, and I think this is a really important point, we can do research in New Zealand and that is very informative, but it's not necessarily going to be indicative for what the experience is gonna be like for Americans. There's cultural differences, there's social differences in terms of New Zealand. So I think that, you know, this can inform potentially new messaging or new approaches. But, you know, we always have to bear in mind that, you know, we're doing research in another country and then taking it to another place. And how we explore that is variable.
Thank you. Thomas would like to know if you can address the value of counting seconds while we drop, cover, and hold on. Isn't the duration of the shaking an important piece of information to gather, especially in a coastal zone where there is a risk of tsunami?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a great question. It's one we haven't necessarily incorporated in the immediate shake alert message. The immediate shake alert message is really around just informing people an earthquake is that there's an earthquake detected, and to drop, cover, and hold on, and to protect yourself. And the reason why we keep the messages very simple is because people only have a few seconds to really look at their phone and figure out what to do. And so we don't want to add more information on top of that. I think that, you know, that's definitely a space in terms of other public education, in terms of counting, that may be useful, but for that first initial message that we really do focus on speed and directness for that approach.
Great, thank you.
Thank you for those great questions. Okay, our next speaker is Emily Holland, Public Policy Specialist for the California Earthquake Early Warning Program with the California Governor's Office of Emergency Services. She is presenting today on behalf of her colleague, Amanda Moyer. Emily, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the last minute change-up. I am happy to present on Amanda's behalf. I'm very excited to talk to you about about Earthquake Warning California. It is our new name for the California-specific program within the Governor's Office of Emergency Services for Earthquake Early Warning. This program is the same innovative one, and it goes off of the same technology that Sarah just talked about with Shake Alert, but is specific to the state of California. We are the first in the nation to launch and do public alerting, which started approximately a year ago. We believe that Earthquake Warning California has the ability to help the public, first responders, utility providers, transit systems, and many other industries. And we're very shortly going to be launching a public outreach campaign. Next slide, please. And specifically for how it works in California is that we have, in conjunction with USGS, the California Geological Survey, the Berkeley Seismic Lab, and Caltech, over 700 sensors right now providing real-time information. And when an earthquake occurs, it will hit those three sensors and then produce an alert where the estimation, where the magnitude, shake intensity, and location are estimated. And there are three main ways, which we'll cover in the next slide. So next slide, please. So the three main ways are through apps. And I will say that the MyShake app is produced by UC Berkeley in partnership with Cal OES, who's provided funding to provide public alerting. There are many other apps within the state, which are all great to have, and we would encourage you to have all of them, but the MyShake app is the one that is backed by the state. We also have wireless emergency alerts. These are things that you get on your phone, like WEA or severe, like Amber Alerts or severe weather alerts. And these are things just by enabling the function in your phone you already have access to. But these are only provided when you have good cell phone service, so we encourage people to have all of these available. We also now, very exciting, through a partnership with USGS and Google and Android, there are the Android earthquake alerts, which actually provide, baked into new phones that update their operating system, the ability to get alerts similarly to WEA. So these are all wonderful new strategies that help people get the words more quickly. Also, good things about WEA and Android are that people don't have to go through the steps, but I know that all of you are very interested in getting all the most accessible data. So next slide, please. A little bit more about the MyShake app. So the MyShake app is free, and it's available from Google Play and the Apple App Store. The location services have to be turned on your phone so it knows where you are to figure out how to protect you, and it'll do a push notification. This is constantly being updated. We're taking feedback. A lot of the feedback is taken in, and we hope to continue to provide new advancements and ways to connect. The app collects this data, and it is autonomized, so no personal information is ever collected, but it helps build the science. And one of the goals of this is that eventually we can decrease the area where there's no warning. We all know that with science, there will always be some little area before it's first detected, but the more we can close that area, the more protection and time people are offered. Next slide, please. So I'm happy to answer any questions. I know that this is just one of the things, but we have lots of great tools. We also have a lot of presentations that are available, so please contact us at earthquakeinfo@caloes.ca.gov, and we're happy to do presentations, and we'll have information available at earthquake.ca.gov.
Great, thank you, Emily. I know for myself, I'm going to be asking that these apps be deployed across all of our agency mobile phones, and that's an actionable thing that all of us can do today. Thank you for that. So let's check the Q&A. Are there any questions for Emily?
Yes, Candy asked, is the California Early Warning app available for iPhone?
The app is actually called the MyShake app, and yes, it's currently available for iPhone for free.
Karen asked, I downloaded the MyShake app a while ago and found it to use a lot of power on my phone. Has it been improved?
it is constantly being improved, and we're actually working on a beta version now that will continue to decrease the battery usage. That would be one of the features.
Will earthquake alerts come through Home Smart, including both Google Echo and Echo Dot Alexa?
Not at this time, but that is one definitely one of our goals and another way that people can be protected in their homes.
Great, thank you.
Okay, up next today we have Mark Benthian, Associate Director of Southern California Earthquake Center at USC and the Executive Director of the Earthquake Country Alliance. Mark, floor is yours.
Thank you, Shannon, very much. And for everyone who is participating today, we have about 500 attendees and our great panelists and speakers and moderators. And, you know, we've been talking about how to protect yourself, of course, during earthquakes. And the basic message of drop, cover, hold on, you know, to drop onto your hands and knees where you are, to then cover your head and neck. And it's not just putting a hand next to your neck. It's really trying to get your arm up as high up and your hand back over your neck as possible so that you're really protecting as much of your head and neck as you can. And if there's something you can get next to, or rather get under, something near you that you can get under for additional shelter, do that. If there's not something you can get under, get next to a wall or something that will provide protection from how many ways things can be coming at you so that you're limiting, again, the potential for injuries. And then if you're under something or next to something that you can hold on to it in case it starts to move in the earthquake shaking and be ready to move with it. If you're not under something, have both of your hands and arms up over your head and neck as best as you can. These are all, you know, the best as you can guidance is really key too. You do what you can to limit the potential exposure to being hit by falling or flying objects. Now, that's a way of saying it. We also have videos. And for the rest of the presentation today, we're going to be showing you our earthquake safety video series in different formats. And I'm going to show this video of what to do if you feel shaking and you're near a desk or table.
Great shakeout earthquake drills remind you to drop, cover, and hold on to protect yourself during an earthquake in most situations. Let's practice what to do if a sturdy desk or table is nearby. When you feel shaking, immediately drop down onto your hands and knees. An earthquake is less likely to knock you over in this position, and you're a smaller target for anything falling or flying. Then, cover your head with your arms. Clasp your hands around your neck. Bend over to protect your vital organs. If you can move safely and a sturdy desk or table is nearby, keep one arm over your head as you crawl to additional shelter. Finally, hold on by gripping a table leg or other part of your shelter. Continue protecting your head and neck with your other arm. Remain on your knees and bent over, ready to move with your shelter when it shifts during the shaking. Close your eyes and mouth to protect against dust and debris. Remain in this position until the shaking stops. After the shaking is over, wait a moment and check all around and above you before getting up or leaving your shelter. Register at Shake.
So that's one example of the videos we have. This is an animated GIF version of another video showing what to do if there's not a desk or table nearby. Now, there have been some comments about, what if the table were to collapse? That is part of that triangle of life theory that Michelle mentioned earlier and has been broadly discredited. You want to, there are items that are going to fall that you want to protect yourself by being under something additionally or next to a wall. In this case, she's next to cupboards, but it's really limiting the way that things can be falling or flying at you. We are going to be showing a variety of other protective actions for the rest of the webinar here, and including for people with disabilities. So hold on your questions, that's coming up in the next presentation. But generally, if you can't get down for any reason and get back up again on your own, you should follow this guidance of staying seated, and we'll talk more about that later. All of the guidance you can find on our Step 5 webinar, or rather general Step 5 page at earthquakecountry.org/step5, and in Spanish at terremotos/paso5. And the videos are on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/greatshakeup. Now, here's a video of what to do in bed. That is also available. Basically, you're going to turn over, and for sake of time, I'm not going to show this right now, but you can find that on our website. You want to turn over, lay face down, and put the pillow over your head. Getting up is going to, again, get you exposed to things that are falling or broken glass, especially at night. So stay in bed, cover your head is the guidance there. And then if you're driving a car, you want to, if you notice the earthquake, you want to pull over. Try not to be under a bridge or under something that might be falling. Drive a few more seconds away and under and out from under that, and set the brake and just wait for the shaking to stop. And then if you're in a stadium or theater, it's similar principles. And I'll show this video right here.
Let's practice what to do if you're in a stadium, theater, or other location with rows of chairs. When you feel shaking and if there's enough space at your feet, immediately drop onto your hands and knees. An earthquake is less likely to knock you over in this position, and you are a smaller target for anything falling or flying. Then, cover your head with your arms as best as you can while clasping your hands around your neck. Bend over as far as possible to protect your vital organs. Finally, hold on by gripping the leg of a chair with one hand and continue protecting your head and neck with your other arm. Close your eyes and mouth to protect against dust and debris. Remain in this position until the shaking stops.
Okay, so we're not suggesting that you try to get down under the theater chair. You're just getting down below the height of the chair so that if something big falls, it's more likely to hit that. We're now looking at what to do near the shore. We have a video on this too. This is just a short version. You know, if you're near the shore, which also includes maybe in a building near the shore, you want to protect yourself, drop, cover, hold on first. And then once the shaking has stopped and you can move, or if it's subsided to where you can move, then move to high ground or inland. So that general information, you can learn more at tsunamizone.org, drop, cover, hold on, and then go to high ground or inland, and then stay there because tsunami waves may arrive for hours. We have all of these videos and these short versions of them, these animated versions, which are great for sharing with others on social media, on our Shakeout webpage, youtube.com/greatshakeout, and at shakeout.org/messaging. Just scroll down to the bottom and you'll find that. I also want to mention that the entire presentation is now available on the earthquakecountry.org/safer-at-home webpage where you registered, the PDF of all the slides, and the recording will be online by next week. Some other settings, if you're in a high-rise, if you're in a classroom, if you're in a store, you're dropping, covering, and holding on. But you know, if you want to be away from windows in the high rise, you want to move towards the inside because the swaying of the building, you don't want to be near the windows. And if some classrooms, the general drop, cover, hold on applies, but if it's a chemistry classroom or laboratory, you're going to need other safety considerations and have a plan for what to do. And if you're in a store, it might be getting next to your shopping cart, beneath clothing racks, or if it's a warehouse store, even getting into the first level of the racks may provide protection from things that may be falling from above. We also have guidance for young children and really for everyone. Drop, cover, hold on, just like Rocket. Rocketrules.org is a great resource with new materials for children ages 5 through 9. There are storybooks and activity books, coloring pages and other activities that you can now download, all of these at rocketrules.org. For free, or you can also purchase them too. FEMA has a free poster. This is going to be available in the PDF. You're basically emailing the address here, and if you just kind of search for FEMA 1078, you should be able to find that. You can email femapubs@gpo.gov and ask for that in the number of copies. Send your address and they'll send those to you for free. And I'm going to skip this just for sake of time. But that leads us into Shakeout. So Shakeout, of course, is when you can practice all this. We have tons of resources in both English and Spanish, and also information for what to do to how to adapt your Shakeout drill because of COVID-19. So go to shakeout.org/COVID-19 or shakeout.org/espanol/COVID-19. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. You know, I know that I went through the Rocket Rules materials with my kids so that I would know that even if we're not together, that they're going to take protective actions, I can take protective actions, and then I can check on them afterwards. So that's a great resource. Before we continue, let's pause for questions from the Q&A. Sharon?
Thank you. We have a question. The only thing I can get under is my glass table. Is getting under a glass table safe?
Yeah, this comes back to the point Michelle Wood was mentioning earlier about situational awareness. These are principles that apply kind of generally, but you need to customize for your particular situation. You know, some glass these days, like on our phones and others, is super strong and unbreakable almost, but maybe not your table. So you may need to consider that and find another place to be safe.
What should you do if you're driving on a bridge at the time of an earthquake?
If you're able to drive a few more seconds and get off that bridge, that is ideal. In California, most of our freeway bridges have been retrofitted since earthquakes where there were collapses, and those that had been retrofitted in those earthquakes did not collapse. So the retrofitting program is complete. But you know, if you can move off the bridge, it would be recommended, and especially if you're under an overpass, to try to move forward and out from under the underpass.
Great, thank you.
We'll have some more time for questions later on, but we need to move on to our next presenter.
And thank you everyone for those. Our final presenter today is someone who I consider a mentor and a friend, Heidi Rozovsky. She's the Inclusive Planning Specialist with Global Vision Consortium and the co-chair of the ECA Southern California. So the floor is yours, Heidi.
Great, thank you. Today we're going to be talking, I'm going to be talking a little bit about anyone who has limited mobility or mobility disabilities. We have a video series that goes through different using disability adaptive equipment and so forth, and gives you ideas of what you can do. So those videos are available at the youtube.com Great Shakeout. And we also have the full videos and the GIFs that I'll be using in the Shakeout messaging. Next. The video for mobility devices for individuals who use mobility devices is all one video, but it's set up with timestamps so that you can go to the area that applies to your situation. Next. So for an individual who uses a wheelchair when there is a table or something protective nearby.
If you are using a wheelchair and feel shaking, try to move away from windows or objects that could fall or fly and injure you. Stay as low in your chair as possible throughout the shaking. Remain in your wheelchair and lock your wheels or secure a seatbelt if you have one. Do not try to transfer during the shaking. If you can, cover your head and neck with your arms or with a protective object, such as a pillow or a book. If you feel that strong shaking may throw you from your chair, hold on to the chair with one hand. Close your eyes and mouth to protect against dust and debris. When the shaking stops, look around and above you to ensure it's safe before you start to move. Visually check your body for injuries, particularly any areas of reduced sensation or that look or feel different than usual.
So instead of drop, cover, and hold on, the guidance is lock, cover, and hold on. An individual using a power chair you move to a corner or a safe place that is going to provide the least amount of situations where you could have objects thrown at you. So those inside corners are the place to be. You want to turn your power chair off. That's how most power chairs break these days. If you still have one that has a manual brake, shut that manual brake down. And then you want to cover yourself with your hands or any protective object you may have, and you want to hold on. For individuals who use double crutches or arm braces, this is a video section for them.
If you are using double crutches and feel shaking, try to move away from windows or objects that could fall or fly and injure you. Carefully drop down as low on the floor as possible. If you can, cover your head and neck with your arms or with a protective object such as a pillow or a book. If no such protective object is available, clasp your hands around the back of your neck with your arms and protect the side and top of your head as best as you can. Bend over to protect your vital organs. Close your eyes and mouth to protect against dust and debris. When the shaking stops, look around and above you to ensure it's safe before you start to move. Visually check your body for injuries, particularly any areas of reduced sensation or that look or feel different than usual. Call out for help if you need assistance getting up, reaching your crutches, or navigating through any debris.
And this is if you use a cane. For a lot of people, they can drop, they can cover, and hold on. Some people have difficulties getting up, and that's where it's nice to be able to call out to someone or have people come check on you. And we'll talk about a personal support team later. And if you use a manual walker and there's a chair nearby, you're going to try to move to that chair. Mark. Bend over to protect those vital organs, cover your head and neck, and hold on as much as possible. And then check again for what's going on around you. Is it safe for you to move? Do you need to yell out for help, whether or not you have any injuries? And if you have no chair nearby, you can use the walker to provide a little more space by getting down on your knees or down below the level of the walker. And again, protect your head and neck and your vital organs. If you use a rollator, and there's a chair nearby, you are going to want to just get drop, cover, and hold on as you've seen with the others, the lock, cover, and you want to lock that the rollator wheels. And as you see, she has difficulty getting her hands up, so just do the best you can at that point and protect your vital organs. Next. If someone has limited upper body movement, you know, that it may be difficult to do the lock, cover, and hold on. In this case, this gentleman keeps his phone on a cord around. So if he gets a alert from my shake, he knows that he can move to, that he's in, getting into a corner and he's getting himself in a position to protect himself as much as possible. He has difficulty covering his neck. He's trying. In his case, it might be better for him to just bend over and protect those vital organs as much as possible. And as you can see, his eyes are closed and his mouth are closed. Again, look around for hazards, check for reduced sensation, and connect with your personal support team. We're going to go on and talk about what that is. And this is something that everybody should have. You need at least three people who can come to your assistance immediately. So they need to be within walking distance, basically, who you have talked to about how best to assist you, how to help you with any of your assistive devices, what they need to do to evacuate you and any of your supplies if that's necessary. And you should all practice together and prepare together. This is important, again, if you can't get up or from under a table without assistance, you'll know that at least your support team is gonna come help you. It's really important to keep exits and pathways clear. The earthquake may, you know, spill a lot of things from cabinets and so forth that creates debris, which is why you want to create safe space and secure furniture and cabinets and anything that might prevent injury. This situation would be very difficult for someone who is blind to navigate with their things may have shifted and the cues they use may not be available. Again, if you were using a walker or a wheelchair trying to navigate with all this would be very difficult. The picture that's on your right, it actually is a picture of a gentleman's home from the Ridgecrest earthquake. Next. If you have a service animal, you want to try and keep that animal protected with you under a table or next to the chair. The service animal may be frightened after an earthquake or injured themselves, and they may not be able to work immediately. So be prepared on what you would do in advance. Take a look at what you would do if your service animal was not able to work immediately. Also be really careful in moving around debris, not to that your animal may be injured. a lot of resources that we have that the committee that Shannon is the leader for is a bunch of stakeholders and people with disabilities who have developed this, and it includes a guide that has messages that are adapted from the seven steps that has specific guidance for people with disabilities. And that's available at earthquakecountry.org/disability. Questions?
That was fantastic, Heidi. Thank you. Sharon, are there any questions?
I do have a question from Alan. He asks, can someone explain why it is safer for someone in a wheelchair to bend over and protect their legs with their back and spine if their legs are no longer functioning?
It isn't actually your legs that you're looking to protect. You're bending over to be able to protect your core of your body where your vital organs are located.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
That's it.
Okay, in a moment, we'll continue taking additional questions on the topics presented today. But first, I wanna make sure that everyone knows about our next webinar, which is scheduled for October 21st at 11 a.m., which will be about how to improve safety after the earthquake. Appropriately, this will be the week after shakeout. Learn more at earthquakecountry.org/safer-at-home. This is also where the recordings from today's webinar will be available sometime next week. While some of us are able to stay to answer some questions, I want to thank all of our panelists for their wonderful presentations today and being subject matter experts that they are. And thank you attendees for joining us. When you leave, a webpage will appear with a link to a brief survey about today's webinar. Please take a moment to complete it. You can also find that link at the bottom of the Safer at Home webpage. If you have additional questions, please email info@earthquakecountry.org. And if you are leaving now, have a great day. Thank you for joining us. Otherwise, Sharon and Mark, what other questions do we have?
We have a question from Karen. She asked, what is the recommendation for people who are trying to protect children and the elderly?
What you need to do is you need to be the model of what they need to do. This is true. You see teachers do this a lot where they're really trying to get the kids underneath. You need to make sure that you get down and that if you need to help that child down, that you are doing that from a space that you're not likely to get knocked over. And then again, protecting yourselves and model for them what they need to do as well. I hope that answered that question.
I'll add on to that, Heidi, is great. And it really is the emphasis of securing your space. Our step one webinar talked all about how to secure things so they won't fall, especially in rooms where your children or elderly parent may be, that you have less to worry about during the earthquake. You want to protect yourself before you go to them so that you actually can get to them and help them and not have them need to come and help you. And get practicing all of this in advance, having family drills like you could do a shakeout, also a great idea.
Thank you. Another question for Heidi from Vincent. Is it better that mobility and disability wise, recommending people to stay on first or second floors of facilities and buildings?
That's a personal choice. It isn't necessary from a standpoint of limiting yourself to those spaces. I believe it was the Northridge earthquake at the time, the mayor's office on disability was on the 24th floor of City Hall. They had a stair chair, they brought a lady down who has MS, all of those 24 flights. If you do spend a lot of time on higher floors because of work or where you live, you really need to take a look at what you need to do to be able to protect yourself and then get down out of there if needed. And that's where the personal support team can come in as well in terms of helping you.
Thank you. I have a question for Emily Holland. What is the intensity of earthquake to receive an alert? and who will be receiving those alerts in relation to geographic place of residence?
A great question. So we have two different thresholds, one of which is for the mobile apps, and that's a magnitude 4.5 earthquake, with where people experience shake intensity of MMI 3, which is light shaking. And that, and whether you'll receive that alert depends on what the shaking you'll receive is and how far you are away, roughly, from the earthquake. For WEA alerts, it's a 5.0 with shake intensity 4. So there are two different thresholds, but really, if you get an alert, depends on if you're to feel that shaking. So there have been some instances where people who are farther away might feel it. And in all these cases, no matter what, whether you get an alert or feel shaking, drop cover and hold on, or lock cover and hold on. Don't wait for an alert to tell you to do that behavior.
Thank you. Carlos asks, what range of seconds would a warning come before the shaking might begin?
In this case, our hope is that you can get seconds. But there are some cases where you might get an alert after you start to feel that shaking. That will also, kind of as Sarah pointed out that Jill Barnes said, it might tell you sooner to do something. It might also tell you, if you're questioning whether it's an earthquake and you haven't been as well-trained as everyone on this webinar, we hope it will also encourage people to do those actions. But the ultimate goal is for it to come a couple seconds before. That is a few seconds before, that's our hope.
Can I add to that?
Of course.
Okay, it depends on where you're located relative to the epicenter of, you know, where the earthquake originates. So if you're farther away, it also depends on the ground and what it's made of. But what, generally speaking, when you're farther away, you know, the earthquake will be detected at the source, and it will take a while to travel to you, so you would have more time. So it really depends on where you are located and a few other things.
Thank you. I have a question for Mark. Would it be a good idea to keep a bike or skateboard sports helmet next to your bed or office desk? I never hear any suggestions for this vital, simple device when I'm hearing about earthquake preparedness.
All right, and just to be clear, this is not talking about keeping a bike or skateboard, but rather the helmet that you would wear. I believe that's what they're asking. I mean, there are certainly ways that you can increase your safety, and having a helmet nearby that you can grab and put on would do that. We don't recommend that broadly. That's not something that everybody has or can do. But, you know, anything you can do to make sure you have, you know, the table you purchase is really sturdy, really thick legs, all of that is a great idea.
And another one for Mark from Angela. What if bed and table are located close to windows?
Yeah, if your drapes or window coverings are closed, it should prevent the glass from coming out onto you on the bed. You might shift to the other side of the bed, but we still don't recommend that you get out of bed.
A question for Dr. McBride. Juan asks, in my doctoral dissertation regarding protective actions during earthquakes, I sustained the need to develop an individual choreography for every possible situation. My question, what is your opinion about the need to learn those protective actions as individual choreographies that should be practiced during drills?
Hi, Juan. Of course, I know of your excellent research, and I know you're doing some fantastic work in this space. So I would agree. The more that people can develop what we would call procedural knowledge, some people call it muscle memory. I kind of like procedural knowledge better, which is basically the more you do something, the more you develop a procedure on how to get something done. And the more environments you practice in, When there is actually shaking going on, or you receive a shake alert, you know much more what to do. You're not having to sort of stop and think and wait and then take action. It becomes much more automated. It's like, you know, protective action is driving a car. The more you drive a car, the more you learn how to drive a car, the better you are at it. And the same thing is with shakeout and drop cover hold on and the suite of actions that would be recommended. So yeah, you're absolutely on the money, Juan. Thank you so much for that question.
Thank you. A question from Cindy. What about covering under a desk in a cubicle? They are all attached, so this is not a stable wall and have cabinets on top.
Hi, I'll answer that. So really, it's anything that can protect you from falling or flying objects. You're less concerned about the building falling in our building codes especially. And it's rare in general. You may have an earthquake, you may have some buildings collapse. You'll have thousands of buildings that don't collapse, but in probably in all of them, you have things that are falling or flying. Probably won't break apart your cubicle if something falls on it in that sense. And you're just better, and if only that might be in the largest of earthquakes, but in smaller, moderate earthquakes, you'll be safer under something than not.
Thank you. We have a question also for Mark. I work in a skilled nursing facility and it's hard to get patient participation. Any tips or suggestions to increase participation?
I'm assuming this question is about shakeout and the shakeout earthquake drill.
Correct.
And this really is about conversations in advance, sharing information and talking to them about the importance of practicing what to do and how it can be applied to their particular situation.
I would like to add to that, if I may. The social science research on human behavior would suggest that it would be good to get a champion from the community, somebody who can either be a leader or someone who just represents the community who talks about the benefits of doing that and how they have done that, and that would be more effective than a more top-down kind of messaging. So that's something that can be used to help.
Great, thank you. That's all I have.
I do see another question about, just to answer a few more, do you recommend taking online and in-class CERT trainings for emergency preparedness and safety for the community and your family? Certainly. There is now an online CERT program coming out from FEMA. CERT stands for Community Emergency Response Team. Normally it's a 20-hour in-person training. And this really does provide you the skills that you need to be able to help your family, help your neighbors, work together to provide first aid, to put out small fires, general preparedness information and safety training. So it's really useful for that. There's also a question about leaving patients in the hallway at a hospital or other facility, or do nurses wait with the patients if they are not mobile? And does anybody else have a question, an answer for that? If they're on the 9th floor.
I'll take it. One of the things that you really need to do in this situation is make sure that you've discussed with the employer or the whoever runs the facility about planning ahead how you are going to evacuate your patients if need be, or evacuate the people who are on the 9th floor. You're still going to need to drop, cover, and hold on in the best and safest place possible, and then exiting that building, egressing from it, would probably require something like a stair chair, and it's going to require a situation where you have people who are trained in taking that stair chair down. Practicing drills using that stair chair so that people understand how it's done and can overcome their fear of it, so that that does not block anyone's or create resistance to being evacuated that way is a good idea. So this really needs to be a plan that is set up ahead of time and practiced ahead of time.
Thanks, Heidi. All right, as a last little bonus bit of content to share with those of you who remain today, I shared earlier today the Rocket Rules materials for kids. This is a video they have made that really kind of summarizes much of what we've talked about. It's not just for kids, it's great for everyone, and you can find it at rocketrules.org. And so I'm going to share this now.
But what do we do if we're at home and an earthquake is actually happening? That's easy. Drop, cover, and hold on. Drop to a safe place and hold on. If you aren't near a table, get against a wall or away from anything that could fall. Get down, cover your head and neck, and hold on. If you're in bed, turn face down to protect your belly. Cover your head and neck with a pillow, and don't leave the bed. If you're in a wheelchair, lock your wheels so your chair can't roll around in the shaking. Get as small as you can. You can and cover your head and neck with something strong, like a book. Now, how about if an earthquake happens when you're outside? In that case, stay away from buildings, windows, trees, telephone poles, or anything that could fall on you. Get on the ground and cover your head and neck. If you're in the car, remind your parents to stop at the side of the road. Stay in the car, scrunch down, and protect your head and neck. Lastly, if you're at school when an earthquake happens, follow your school's earthquake plan. Most schools have earthquake drills to practice what to do when an earthquake happens. If you're not sure about your school's earthquake plan, ask your teacher to explain it to you. Now, when the shaking is over, that doesn't mean that the earthquake is over. There can still be aftershocks, which are smaller earthquakes. Again, stay away from anything that could fall, and be ready to drop, cover, and hold on.
Shannon, with your final word, and I want to thank you for hosting today and all of our panelists, and I'll leave it with Shannon for the final thanks.
The final thought is that there is a lot we can be doing, and it all comes down to practice and plan, right? And so all of these actions, if you practice them at home, you practice them with your kids, you practice them in the facilities that you work, you're going to be better prepared when the shaking happens. And the Shake Alert are tools that we can use to give ourselves peace of mind and a little bit of an earlier response time. So thank you all for your time. Thank you for our panelists for their expertise, and have a great day and a great shakeout in October.